Enjoy this video by Freddie Marsh Latt.
Well, some folks like whiskey, and whiskey's mighty fine. Some folks like moonshine, Lord, they drink it all the time. My daddy taught me, said, son, only way to keep your head in line, drink that wine, 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 keep your head stoned all the time. That's what it said. Look at them luscious little bottles sitting up on the shelf, red, green, and yellow, Lord, they are something else. They mesmerize me, the way they sparkle and shine. Drinking that wine, 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 keep your head stoned all the time. One snort of rhubarb pour really ring the bell. Then a glass of muscatel set my head up well. Finished with a bottle of cheapest sherry wine, I say goodbye to my mind. While folks around me, sis, don't start and war,
baloney,
fighting and hollering, getting off the shore, yeah. Politics and business, I don't pay them no mind. Drinking that wine, 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 keep your head stoned all the time.
Tell the truth.
Snort a rhubarb pour, really ring the bell. Then a glass of muscatel, set my head up well. Finished with a bottle of cheapest sherry wine, I say goodbye to my mind. While the folks around me, sis, don't start to roar. Some business, yeah. I don't pay them no mind. Drinking that wine, 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 keep your head stoned all the time. Well, get out the bathtub, oh, yeah. Grandma, take off your socks.
Yes, it was a beautiful day. It's gonna be a beautiful night. Break out the champagne. Everybody get a glass. Let's start it off sexy. What do you say? And all the ladies say. And all the ladies say. I think I like that. And all the ladies say. Welcome to the champagne life, where trouble is a bubble in a champagne glass. Dreams and reality are one and the same. And we gon' do it like this.
Got an addiction for life in this baby. Like every day's my birthday, you know what I'm getting. And reserve the time, not just that's where I'm sitting. Me and my friends in about 6 minutes independence. And my attitude so chill and so breezy. Design a suit to make this look easy. Sexy baby, don't you dare act like
the days of wine and roses, laugh and run away like a child at play through the meadowland toward a closing door, a door marked nevermore that wasn't there before. Discloses just a passing breeze filled with memories of the golden smile that introduced me to the days of wine and roses and you.
This is California.
Hey, this is my state.
We're California farmers.
I'm a California farmer.
I am a California farmer.
And if there's one thing we know, it's food. I grow it.
And I cook it.
I take it from the farm to the city.
We would not do well in Hollywood, would we?
Love what you eat.
Know what you love. This
is California Country.
All I can do, I've got
like to say I'm the owner and winemaker of Vision Cellars, but I'm married to Miss Lil, so I just make the wine for Miss Lil. Well, you know, it's kind of interesting how I got into wine. I grew up 8 or 9 miles south of Dallas, Texas. I grew up way in the woods, way in the country, you know. I consider myself as an old organic kind of a guy, growing back up in there, squirrel-eating type of a guy. At 12 years old, there used to be a bunch of hunters used to come down in these woods and go hunting with my grandfather and drink my father's moonshine. So one of them used to drink Burgundy, and these guys would give him a hard time about drinking that Burgundy wine, blah, 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 because they was drinking corn whiskey. So one day he said to me, he says, "Hey, son, would you like to have this bottle of wine?" And I said, "Yes," but, you know, 12 years old, I didn't know how to get it open, but I finally dug out, the cork out of it, and I took a stick and shoved off in there, and I tasted it, you know. Yeah, you know, you don't have to worry about Child Protective Service because they didn't have anything back off in those woods to do that anyway. But at any rate, I tasted it and I drank a half a bottle of that wine that day. And it tasted pretty good. From that point on, all I talked about was that I wanted to be a winemaker. Fast forward through high school, my coach says to me, "If you want to make wine, you need to move to California." That's why I moved from California. From Texas to California. I grew up about 8 or 9 miles south of Dallas, Texas, around Palestine, Waco, and that area. So getting to California, it's a really a tough time getting to know winemakers, and I didn't know who they were, what they do, any of that thing. So I started hanging around up in Mendocino County, which is about 160 miles north of San Francisco. Met a guy by the name of John Parducci up there, and John wouldn't give me the time of day, but that was okay because, some kid coming out of Texas talking about you want to make wine. But I kept going back up there, and he started talking to me, telling me stuff. But really what kicked me off into this wine business is I met a family over in Napa Valley, a family called the Wagner family. And I hung out with Mr. Wagner probably for 9 months, and I didn't know who he was. He didn't say anything about who he was. And one day the tasting room manager came out and said, "Hey, why are you always out here bothering Mr. Wagner?" And I said, "Well, what do you mean, that old guy out there?" He goes, "That ain't just some old guy, that's Mr. Wagner. He owned this place." I had no idea for 9 months I'd been hanging out with the owners of Camus Vineyard. Fast forward a little bit farther, I've known the Wagner family for around 31 years. 15 years or so after hanging out with them, Mr. Wagner said to me, "Son, you ought to be in the wine business." And I thought, well, I'd like to, but I don't have that kind of money. He goes, "Don't worry about it, we'll take care of you." So 17 years ago, my wife, I, Miss Lil, we started Vision Cellars. And to this day, I'm the only non-family member that's allowed to make wine at Camus. All my wines are crafted at Camus Vineyard in Rutherford, California. I make them all myself. We own some vineyards in Sonoma County, which is about 110 miles north of San Francisco, Russian River Valley. We own Miss Lil's vineyard there, and we do craft wine from that vineyard. That's basically how I got into the wine business. Pinot Noir is what we do. Folks often ask me, why do you choose or select the toughest type of grape? Well, number one, if you in California, Northern California, and you want to make Cabernet, unless you come out of Napa Valley, folks normally think it's not that good. So I thought if I could craft a great Pinot Noir, because Burgundy is the same grape, that if I could craft a good Pinot Noir, then I think I could play with the big dogs. I'm pretty competitive in everything that I do, so I wanted to be good. I wanted to make a mark for doing what I was doing. And at the time, there was a winery in California called William & Sellum that I thought was doing a great, great job, And then I also thought Sanford down in the Santa Barbara. Those were the only two great Pinot producers, that I thought was really, really good. And I thought, if I could make a great, great Pinot Noir, then I could compete. That's why they were selected. I had no idea all the crazy things about that grape even exist, but I'm a pretty fast learner, so I learned a lot about it. Well, it's it's a real challenging thing, because if you think normally about the clones of a Pinot Noir grape, you know, the challenge of growing the grapes, making the wine, and selecting the right yeast, and keeping the temperature at a certain control. To start off with, you know, you have to really know your soil condition and really match your soil condition with your rootstock. You know, rootstock, how much water you have, you know, the soil condition, how much you want to grow per ton. Like a Sauvignon Blanc, it doesn't care. It's like a weed. You can just overload it with tons and tons of fruit. Now, in the Chardonnay world, let's say you have about 50, 60 plus clones someplace in there, different varieties, different clones. Same with the Sauvignon Blanc, Chardonnay and Cabernet Sauvignon. You have about 50 or 60 there. But in the Pinot world, you know, you have about 11,000 clones. You know, these things just mutate. You know, you start out, example, with a 667 or a 777 clone. And you may have one side of the road, you may have this clone planted over there, the other side, another different clone, and they'll completely go different flavors. Then you get into, you know, the pruning process of it. You know, you talk to different Pinot growers, and, you know, they have different methods of, you know, pruning. And I just like a little bit of exposure to my fruit. It's really consistent with leaf picking. In other words, if you get more sun on the east side, you may want to leave a little bit more leaves on that. You don't get enough on the west side of the vine, you may want to pull some of that off. You know, and so it's a constant juggle of trying to get the ripeness and the even ripeness on the fruit itself. In fact, even here in the state of Ohio, you know, their Pinot program is doing pretty good. I gave a big lecture at Ohio State several years ago on the crafting of Pinot Noir, and I came back and tasted what some of the things that they made adjustments in, and they're doing pretty good. But it's a real tough grape to grow. There's a whole bunch of choices of selections of yeast that you use to ferment, you know, your fruit, and that makes a big difference in the end result of the flavor. The type of yeast you use help determine the flavor you get on the end. And then you have the other extreme of that. Barrel selections is really, really critical, because in my mind, a Pinot Noir should be treated like a white grape. It's a delicate thing. You can get too much wood on it, or you can get too much alcohol in it. I'm not saying that, you know, if you like high alcohol Pinot Noir, you shouldn't buy them, but I'm just thinking that, you know, 13.5, 14.5 in there is ideal of alcohol level for a Pinot Noir. Now, with that said, sometimes, you know, your vineyard, the fruit is just not there, you know, at a 25 Brix with a, you know, equivalent to a 13.8 or 13.9 Pinot Noir. And so you may have to let the alcohol get up a little bit higher, because, you know, it's a little bit riper. So the riper it is, the higher the sugar content, and the higher the sugar content is, how the alcohol is going to be in the finished product. So it's kind of a up and down thing with that grape in that sense as well. From my mind, what makes California fruit is a little bit more consistent is that we've kind of figured out what type of soil condition, what type of weather patterns that you have is the best area to grow Pinot Noir. And we found that, you know, nice cooler areas, cool at night, maybe a little bit warmer during the day, you know, 80s and not too high into the hundreds and stuff like that, well, it's more ideal for drinking and making Pinot Noir, because you don't get the over ripe fruit all the time, unless you purposely trying to do that. So I think that we're a little bit more consistent in it. We do have a tendency to get a little bit more alcohol, you say, than say Burgundy or say Oregon. But I think when you look at Northern California, I think we're pretty consistent at finding good location to grow Pinot Noir. And I think that's really the determining factor. Burgundy, you know, they don't get a lot of, you know, heat in the Burgundy area, so your alcohol normally is not as high, and the wine can last, you know, a lot longer. Of course, we make our wines in California so that they'll be able to be consumed a little bit earlier. Now, when I get into California itself, and I think about Cronuts, I think about the more dense, more, you know, maybe a little bit more hardier of Pinot Noir, because you don't have a lot of, you know, hot weather, you know, in that Cronuts area. It's right close to the water. You get over in this Sonoma County, where I live, Sonoma County, you know, Russian River Valley, ideal for Pinot Noir. You know, our property is maybe 3/4 mile from the Russian River, which, you know, nice and cool in there. When the ocean itself is about 45 miles away, it's nice and cool in that Russian River Valley, where you get up in the 80s. Once in a while, you get up, you know, 95 or so like that. But normally, it's in the 80s, and at night, it kind of cools down. So you get more of a cherry, a real ripe plum kind of a fruit from that area. Not as dark as it is in Cronuts. And then when you get down to Monterey County, to the St. Lucia Highlands, particularly upper part of the St. Lucia Highlands, you know, around Soledad, in that area, you know, I purchased fruit from the Gary's and Rosella's Vineyard and the Los Arturos Vineyards, which is owned by the Wagner family. And I tell you, that's an ideal area itself for growing a Pinot Noir. You still get that little dense kind of a fruit there. The acid can be high in that area, a lot higher than it is in, say, Russian River Valley, Sonoma County, or Cronuts, or in Napa area, and part of it is in Sonoma. But the acids can be pretty high down in the St. Lucia Highlands and Monterey County. And I think that when you get down past, you know, Santa Barbara in that area, now you're picking up a little bit more, you know, a little bit more riper fruit, a little bit lighter fruit, and you can kind of get more of what I call that candy apple, kind of a bright, sweet, kind of a, you know, real cherry, real, not wild cherry, but real bean, kind of a light cherry kind of a wine. And with maybe a little bit of berries and the typical raspberry flavors down there. I don't think that that's a problem with that, but I think we are consistent in all the areas that, you know, we're making Pinot Noir in. We're finding out that the temperature in itself in those areas makes a big difference in how Pinot Noir should be coming out, and how the, you know, the trellising of the vines, and how you can actually, you know, get the exposure to the grape, to the sunshine that you need. That we can't change the sun, but we can change how the sun hit the fruit itself by the way we prune it, about we go out and pick the leaves off of it. So I think overall, Californians learn how to farm, is the bottom line. Now Oregon, a lot of folks in Oregon, you know, they kind of maybe lived or made wine in California, so they've taken a lot of the practice up there that we had. But they started out in Oregon using the fruit from that area and not trying to make it, you know, a California Pinot Noir style. You know, they started out really light because they didn't get a lot of sun, a lot of heat. So they were able to just make a wine from the area, and it was so different than California. And I can remember when I used to go up there and I taste those Pinot Noirs, and I used to think, oh, what do these guys think they're doing? Because I was adjusted to, you know, drinking a little bit different style of Pinot Noir. But I think overall they're doing a great job, you know, in making their Pinot Noirs up in Oregon and in parts of Washington as well now.